One of the funny things that's been happening about this evening, or these two evenings, when I mentioned it to our middle schoolers that Kris Langham was coming, they said, "That's the ball guy with the seeds," because we did a set of videos about the seeds to understanding the Word of God. And I thought, okay, they got that much out of it, we're okay. But what's been funny tonight as I listen to you, people are saying, "I hear him all the time and I pictured him different." So I'm gonna let you figure out all the different things. That some thought you were blonde, some thought you had to look like Dr. Oz. I don't know where all this is coming from. I'm not pointing to anybody, Jeannie. But anyway, we're so glad to have Kris Langham tonight. Let me give you my journey with Kris. About 4 years ago, I was doing a Bible study on YouVersion, and it was on Ecclesiastes, and I thought, this is really good. I really enjoyed it. And at the end of it all, I noticed that they had a website and an app, and so I went there. And that's when I started using the app. How many of you young people, or maybe now you're in Fusion or whatever, but you went to the retreat when we did Ecclesiastes in 48 hours? Raise your hand. Anybody remember that one? We did. Remember at the end of it all? What did you learn? They all said, "We're all going to die." That's what they got. We're all going to die. But there was more to it than that. But we had a wonderful time. And through that, I began corresponding with him. And over the last 2 or 3 years, he has been a great blessing to me personally, not only in my time in the morning with the Lord, my understanding, but he's gotten me a lot of resources. And I've learned a lot of different teachers from around the country that have been a blessing. And as I hear different books that they're using and they're quoting, I'm buying those books, and it's just been a great journey for me. And I am so happy tonight to have with us Kris Langham from Through the Word. If you please come, Kris.
Am I on?
I'm on. I'm definitely on.
Hey, if you brought a Bible with you, would you open with me? We're going to be in 1 Samuel, but first I want to show you a verse in Romans, a favorite verse of mine. It is in Romans chapter 10. Hope you're all doing well. I'm doing well. I came in on a red eye this morning, so I got on a plane at midnight last night and arrived at 8 o'clock this morning, and I think I fell asleep a little bit. So if I'm actually still at the hotel dreaming right now, then I hope this goes well. Take a look in Romans chapter 10. If you have your Bible with you, or if you have your phone with you, then you can certainly check and open up Romans chapter 10 on your phone. And we're going to read chapter 10 at verse 17. "Así que la fe viene como resultado de oír el mensaje, y el mensaje que se oye es la palabra de Cristo." Okay, that was actually just my warm-up, because I told Russell I'm going to attempt to preach in Spanish on Sunday, and my Spanish is a little bit rusty, but when I have it right in front of me, I do pretty good. So Pastor Russell was kind enough to get me a Spanish-English Bible, so I've got my cheater notes essentially right next to me. Let's read it in English. Just to check, how many of you understood what I just read? Okay, I kind of figured that's pretty good. How many of you were surprised that I didn't sound like a gringo? How many of you thought I was blonde? Where did that come from? And for that matter, who says I'm not? How do you know? I actually was at one point. I was. Okay, Romans 10:17. "Consequently, faith comes from hearing the message, and the messages heard through the word about Christ. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We ask that you would be our teacher. Give us understanding, give us insight, give us guidance. Lord, as we come to your word, we ask that you would be revealed through it. Holy Spirit, we invite you to come into this time and in this place, and as we read the words from this book, we ask that you would bring them to life, that you'd plant seed in our hearts of faith, and Lord, that we would grow in faith and grow in the knowledge of you. Guide us as we come to you, Lord. Give us understanding and insight, and help us to know your grace, your love, your hope, your salvation for us. We pray these things in Jesus' name, Father. Everybody said?
Amen.
Amen. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing through the word about Christ. What is this thing called faith? We make a big deal of faith in church. Faith is certainly important to any church, whether it be Christian or whatever religion you happen to walk into church for. Faith's always important. In fact, I'd say that faith is even important for those who claim that they have no religion. They're about science. Faith still plays a big part in everyone's life. But certainly, if you're going to follow the God of the Bible, he seems to be pretty big on faith. After all, the one thing that he asks for as a ticket to heaven is faith in his son. That's a pretty cheap price tag on a pretty big ticket. Faith. And here we're told in Romans 10 that faith comes by hearing, and hearing through the word. Well, what is faith? What does it do? Where does it come from? And how does it grow? How is it that we come about faith? Well, we're going to start here. We're going to move into 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel, there's a little chapter, 1 Samuel chapter 3, a little story that's a favorite of mine, means quite a bit to me. If you want to turn back to 1 Samuel chapter 3, I'm going to bring up Romans 10, 17 here and there again, but most of our time we're actually going to be in 1 Samuel 3 and a great story that takes place there at the beginning of Samuel's life. I like stories that give us the backstory. Some of our great heroes. I love to get the backstory on where they came from. Sometimes we get curious on where are they now. Every once in a while you catch up on the internet or some entertainment show and they'll tell you where they are now, your favorite stars from Saved by the Bell or whatever it is that you were a big fan of when you happened to be a teenager. And you wonder where they are now, but in this case, we're wondering, where were they then? Samuel is one of the great heroes of the Bible in the Old Testament. And tonight, and I'm going to be back tomorrow for some of the youth and back on Sunday morning, and I hope that you join us again. We're going to get three stories of our great Bible heroes. In each case, I want you to see their roots, where they came from. When you see somebody that really inspires you, when you see a life that causes you to say, that's the kind of life I want to be able to look back on someday. The impact, the integrity, the heart, the love, the way God flows through that person. Well, where were they then? Where did that come from? We're going to look at three lives. And the first one we're going to look at is a young man named Samuel. And his story here, we're going to begin in chapter 3, 1 Samuel chapter 3. I'm going to read the beginning of the story and then we'll get into the study. Chapter 3, verse 1. The boy Samuel ministered before the Lord under Eli. In those days, the word of the Lord was rare. There were not many visions. One night, Eli, whose eyes were becoming so weak that he could barely see, was lying down in his usual place. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the house of the Lord, where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called Samuel. Samuel answered, "Here I am." And he ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." But Eli said, "I did not call you, go back and lie down." So he went and lay down. Again the Lord called, "Samuel." And Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." "My son," Eli said, "I did not call you, go back and lie down." Verse 7. Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord. The word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. I want you to look at that verse one more time. Samuel, he's a young kid. He's grown up in ministry, in the tabernacle, and closest thing you could get for us would be a church kid, pastor's kid, just grown up. All of life is ministry and God and Bible and everything about it. But look what it says about him. Samuel did not yet know the Lord. The word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. What is faith, and where does it come from? And how does it grow in our lives? It's so important to God, so where do we get it from? Is it something you just choose to blindly give away? Is it something that God simply zaps you with? Or is it something that grows? Is there a way to come about it? Well, Pastor Russell mentioned that the kids told you I was the seed guy. If you've been wondering, I brought these, by the way. And have you ever wondered at the little speck that you find inside of one of these guys? This is a nice crispy apple that you got me. Thank you very much. Have you ever wondered about, you know, you eat your way through the apple. This is crispy and delicious. God made these. I love apples. They're fantastic. But you know the one part that just doesn't make sense to me is this little thing in here. It tastes disgusting. Right at the center of it, I mean, what on earth are those good for? You get down to the core and you just toss them aside because who wants to eat that? Have you ever wondered at the power of a seed? It's an amazing thing, isn't it? Did you know that in this little bitty speck, the most unassuming part of this beautiful little fruit, you know what's inside here? You know what's inside a seed? Inside a seed is the blueprints for an entire tree full of apples. All the information necessary to make roots, to make a trunk, to make the bark, to make the branches, to make the leaves, to make 1,000 more of those delicious little apples, all of that information is contained within a single cell, smaller than you could possibly see. The blueprints for the whole thing. You know what else is inside this seed? All around those blueprints are every tool necessary to make that entire tree out of dirt. You ever wonder how smart God is? Does it ever just blow you away a little bit? All the tools necessary to make a tree out of dirt. I challenge any engineer in the country to make a tree out of dirt. An incredible little machine that keeps producing fruit. In the book of Luke, Jesus tells a little story about seeds. You remember the story of the parable of the sower, it's called, the parable of the sower. Jesus tells the story of a sower, somebody who goes planting seeds. A farmer goes out with a bunch of seed he's carrying, and some of the seed falls along the street, and birds come along and pick it up, and the seed does no good for as far as planting more fruit. And some of the seed falls among rocks, and the rocks spring up a little bit, and springs up a little bit, but gets choked out. When the sun comes, it just doesn't survive. And then some of the seed falls among thorns, and the ones among thorns come up a little bit, but the thorns, they just take too much of the nutrients and can't get the sunshine, and it just doesn't work out. But some of the seed planted on good soil, well, that bears a whole lot more fruit. 30, 60, 100 times fold. Now, it's a great story. And it's about how faith comes to people. But do you remember in his story, there in Luke chapter 8, what is the seed? When the disciples go and ask Jesus, can you explain the story? It sounded fascinating, but what did it mean? Do you remember what the seed is? Jesus explains, he says, the seed is the word of God. The seed is the word of God. Have you ever wondered at this little unassuming book that you hold in front of you? Might not look that like that much, just black letters on a page, a few red ones as well. Like any other book, really, kind of a bigger one. Small print for some of us. But have you ever wondered at what happens with the stuff in here? Did you know that tucked away in this little book, you'll find the blueprints for life? Right in here. And if you'll plant it in good dirt, Jesus says that little seed will spring up to life. Now, you might look at it and say, well, how's that going to happen? But I tell you what, if you were a city boy and never grew up around the farm, and the first time you saw one of these things, I'd say you probably wouldn't expect a whole lot of this little guy. But it'll surprise you. It can do a whole lot. The word of God, Jesus says, is like a seed planted in our hearts. And our job is just to be good dirt, to let it grow. Now, back here in our story, we have this young man named Samuel. Now, Samuel, I won't get into his entire story, but Samuel was dedicated to the Lord by his parents from the time he was very little. His mom had prayed for a child for a long time, didn't happen, and Hannah went to the temple, and she was crying, and the priest Eli thought she was drunk and rebuked her, and she said, she's not drunk, she's crying, she wanted a child, and Eli apologized and gave a word from the Lord, you'll have a son. Well, sure enough, she had a son, and she decided to dedicate his whole life to God. She said, he's going to grow up as close to God as possible, right here in the tabernacle. They didn't have a temple yet, but they had a tabernacle. Eli was the high priest at the time. And his son served alongside of him in working in the, doing God's work in the tabernacle. And Eli grew up among that family and grew up, everything was about God in his life. But is it possible to grow up where everything around you is about God and you miss it? Take a look back at his story. The boy Samuel in verse 1 ministered before the Lord under Eli. In those days, the word of the Lord was rare. There were not many visions. Now, this is a key to understanding the backdrop to this story. In those days, the word of the Lord was rare. In those days is a reference to the time of the judges. If you ever read through the book of Judges in the Old Testament, for me, it's one of the hardest books to read because it was an awful, terrible time among God's people. In that time, what it says about the book of Judges, it's summed up actually in the very last verse of Judges, says, in those days, Israel had no king. Everyone did what was right in his own eyes. Everyone did what was right in his own eyes. Now, when it's said that Israel had no king, it's not just a reference to the fact they didn't have King David or King Solomon or King Saul. That's true, but I think more than that, it meant that they didn't serve God as king. After all, that was their calling, to serve God as king. They were called to be God's people. They were rescued by God. They used God's name all the time. You can read through Judges. They certainly talked about God a lot. They had priests and such. But their version of following God did not look at all like God's direction for following God. They kind of made up their own version of godliness. You might recognize that. It happens around us. Everyone did what was right in their own eyes. Not just the non-believers, the believers. The people supposed to follow God, they did what's right in their own eyes. Today we call that relativism. Whatever's right for you is right for you. Whatever's right for me is right for me. In fact, I would say that the predominant religion in America, at least, I would say is relativism. It's pretty common. It's kind of the core value that you get growing up. I know it was for me. As I grew up, that was like, well, that's just the right thing, right? Whatever's right for you is right for you, and that sounds good. As long as I don't disrespect anybody else, I felt pretty good about myself. Well, imagine a world where everyone does what's right. Wouldn't that be fantastic? Wouldn't that be a great place if everyone you encounter does what's right? Everybody in traffic does the right thing. Everybody who wants to sell you something does the right thing. Everybody's the right thing. Imagine a world. I would propose to you that that's pretty close to the world we have. Everyone does what they think is right for them. I mean, who cares about you? It's about them, right? You do what's right for you. What's right for me is to cut you off in traffic, because I'd really rather be in front of you than behind you. What's right for me is to take your stuff, because I really think I'll enjoy it more than I'll enjoy you having it. Everyone does what's right in his own eyes. That's the world that this story begins in. Samuel was a child in that world. In fact, we're not going to go into the story, but in chapter 2, what we'll see is that it even went to the family of the priests, the one who were supposed to represent God most of all, Eli's sons. They were growing up to be priests, and yet you'll find in the story in chapter 2 that his sons were doing whatever was right in their own eyes. They were going about their godly duties. They were carrying out the sacrifices and their duties. But as they did that, they did it their way. And their way got them a whole lot more money and goods and women than doing it God's way. In fact, they were guilty of abusing the women who would come to the temple seeking the Lord. They would take advantage of their seeking the Lord. When people came to give to God, they'd say, great, give to God, first to me. That's how you get to God. It happens. It can still happen in church today when we try to do what's right in our own eyes. Samuel's growing up in this, and here we have kind of a summary statement of verse 1. In those days, the word of the Lord was rare. There were not many visions. In other words, God wasn't talking much. God allowed the people to choose their own way for a while. But here, God is going to raise someone up. Verse 2. One night, Eli, whose eyes were becoming so weak that he could barely see, was lying down in his usual place. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the house of the Lord where the ark of God was. Two things I want you to see there. Eli is the high priest. He's the one who's supposed to represent God to the people and represent the people before God. He's the connection, the priest. Eli, it says, whose eyes were becoming so weak that he could barely see. Now, one, I think that means he's old and his eyes are going. But two, I think there's a picture here. Eli has not been seeing what's going on with his sons. If you read the rest of the story, there's every indication that Eli was going about his job right, but he kind of kept overlooking everything that his sons were doing wrong and just letting stuff go. And his eyes were getting weak. Couldn't see what was going on right in front of him. But in contrast to that, verse 3, the lamp of God had not yet gone out. Now, I think that means it was late at night. There was the lamp of God. It was in the tabernacle, a menorah. And the lamp that they would light up, and the candle would be lit, and it was a picture of the light of God. God's light shining into our lives. And what it says here is that the lamp of God wasn't out yet. A light will shine in the darkness. God brings a little bit of hope. I started out asking the question about faith. What is faith? Well, faith is a lot of things. And as we go through, I want to help you get an understanding of what faith is. But one thing to understand about faith is that faith and hope are tied closely together. In Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, we have a definition of faith. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things unseen. The substance of things hoped for. In other words, what you hope in is not something that you have right now. Romans says, who hopes for what he already has? Hope is about the future, right? Hope is what you're not holding in your hand, but you're trusting for the future. Faith gives substance to your hope. Faith and hope are tied together inextricably. After all, what's faith without hope? I heard a pastor say it this way recently. It really struck my heart. Faith is the guardian of hope. Faith is the guardian of hope. It is your faith in God's promises that guards the hope that you have in the future. After all, your hope in the future, you know things are going to be great tomorrow. But when you let go of that faith, you start losing your hope and you start going off track. It's your faith that keeps you walking on the straight and narrow towards that which you hope for, the promises of God, eternity in heaven. Faith is a guardian of hope. And without hope, what is faith? If faith were just for today, if you just believe God for this moment and this now, but it was nothing about tomorrow, then what is your faith really about? But God gives us a faith that guards our hope, that is the substance of those things that we hope for. And here we see the lamp of God had not yet gone out. There is hope for God's people. Verse 4. Then the Lord called Samuel. Now this is important. The Lord called Samuel. When it says the Lord called Samuel, it means the Lord, God, called to Samuel. Samuel answered, here I am. And he ran to Eli and said, here I am. You called me. So here's what's going on. Samuel is laying down somewhere in the area of the tabernacle because he had just made himself at home there. He'd grew up there. He hears a voice, hears his name, and so he goes running to the only person he knows around, is Eli the priest. And so he says, what do you need? Now it's the middle of the night, and Eli says, I didn't call for you. Here I am, you called me. Eli said, I did not call. Go back and lie down. So he went and lay down. Verse 6, again the Lord called Samuel, and Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, here I am, you called me. My son, Eli said, I did not call you. Go back and lie down. Now, what's going on here? The God of the universe, the creator of all things, is calling to this young man, and he doesn't get it. It doesn't click. He doesn't understand who's talking to him. I didn't grow up a believer. I grew up in church. I grew up a church kid. I was at church pretty much every week, but I didn't really grow up with faith. By the time we got around to confirmation, I grew up in a tradition that had a confirmation. When you're a teenager, you go to classes and you confirm what it is you believe in. Right about that time, I decided to ditch the whole thing. Because I didn't believe, so why would I want to confirm something I don't believe in? Now, I didn't actually know that much about what I believe, but a friend of mine gave me this new word that made perfect sense to me. It was agnostic. I said, what is that? He told me it was agnostic. I said, what is that? He said, well, it means you don't really know what you believe. And the way he put it, he said, you can't prove all this God stuff and Bible stuff. So it's kind of it's just saying you can't prove it. And since he and I were both studying it to be scientists, we both went into engineering. I said, that makes sense to me. I like the logic behind it. That works. So from then on, I called myself agnostic. Went around campus. I went to I studied engineering in San Diego, and went on campus. And when the Bible thumpers were out, I just walked around. I took a good wide circle around them, and I just avoided the whole situation. I felt pretty hunky dory with my excuse, and that's really what it was. I wouldn't have called it that, but it was really good. Somewhere in the back of my mind and my heart, it kind of worked like this: if by chance there's a God, and I die, and He asks me, I have an answer. Agnostic. I couldn't have known God, person, ma'am, sir. And so I didn't do anything. I was agnostic. I was 19 years old. I was listening to the radio. They were giving away a trip to London to see Van Halen. True story. You had to name 10 songs. They played these 10 little snippets of Van Halen songs. You had to name all 10 of them to win the trip. My best friend and I spent all weekend listening to these little snippets of songs till we figured out all 10 songs. Called in on the radio when they said it's time to call in, and I got it, all 10 songs. I won a trip to London. And went to London, met Van Halen, Sammy Hagar, Eddie Van Halen, Alex, the whole gang. And while I was in London, we went to a big church called St. Paul's Cathedral. How many of you have been to St. Paul's Cathedral? Have you been to London? Gorgeous. Now, I like architecture, and this is like nothing else in the world. Incredible place. I'm walking through St. Paul's Cathedral. My friend is really into art, and so I was not, but I was checking out the artwork with him. And as we're walking through St. Paul's Cathedral, there's a painting on a wall. Now, it's a picture of Jesus. Now, I know that not because I'd met him, but because I'd seen pictures before. And Jesus is outside of a shack, and this shack, it's a rundown shack. It's absolutely covered with vines and mess, and everything's overgrown. And Jesus is standing outside this shack, and you can see he's about to knock. And he's kind of, he's just holding his hand out. They're not like banging the door down. He's about to knock, and something about it just grabbed a hold of my heart. I mean, the artwork had to be 400 or 500 years old. And I something about it, I don't know what, it just grabbed me. And so I stared at it for a while and studied it, and I looked down at the base of this artwork, and there was a verse, Revelation chapter 3, verse 20. And it said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. Whoever will open up, I will enter in and dine with him, and he with me. Behold, I stand at the door and knock." I didn't know what that meant. But it really struck me, so I lit a candle. It was a Catholic church, so I lit a candle. I didn't know what to do. There were candles. I thought, I should do something. And I went about my business. Now, I couldn't tell you then exactly what had happened to me, but I can tell you now that the Lord was calling Samuel, except with my name. Chris. I didn't know how to respond. I was like, is that you? My best friend was there. Was that? And so I just lit a candle and didn't know what it meant. Looking back, I understand that Jesus will not bang down the door. He's a gentleman. He will not force his way into your heart. That's not love. But he stands at the door and knocks. Now, interestingly, now that I know the Bible a little bit, that little verse in Romans, in Revelation chapter 3, was actually written to the church, to a church at Laodicea. It was the lukewarm church, the church that here or there. Their faith had just kind of gone flat and didn't really know what they believed, which is really a whole lot like I was. I consider myself sort of Christianish. I grew up in a church. I just didn't have Jesus in my heart. And the picture there is Jesus outside of his own church knocking on the door asking to be let in. Can you picture that? Can you picture if somebody was outside knocking and we were all in here having a blast and playing our games and talking the talk and singing the songs and Jesus is just sitting out there, is anybody going to let me in? Well, that's where he was with my heart. The Lord is speaking to Samuel. Samuel doesn't quite get it. Why? Verse 7. Verse 7 is really the key to this. In verse 7, now Samuel did not yet know the Lord. The word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. Now, this is important because understand this kid went to church. I mean, his whole life was his version of church. It was, and not just Sundays, it was, or Sabbath days, Saturdays. It was every day. His whole life was surrounded by everything to do with God, but he didn't know God. Do you know what I mean by know God? Now, you guys should get this better than most of my audiences because in Spanish, we have much better understanding of the word know. There's a difference between saber and conocer, right? What's the difference? It took a long time for my Spanish teacher to explain this one. But what's the difference between saber, to know God, and conocer, to know God? It's personal. It's personal. Samuel had plenty of saber. He grew up with it. It was entire schooling. It was everything he did. But he didn't conocer. He didn't know the Lord. Why? Because the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. It was the word of the Lord. Now, I'm convinced he must have been studying the Torah and studying the word. But there's a difference between studying and having it revealed to you. You know what the word reveal means? It's interesting. The book of Revelation is very confusing for a lot of us. And we think the word revelation, sometimes we think that means end of the world. That doesn't mean end of the world. Revelation means a revealing. It's like this. If you have a big stage, if we have a giant curtain here, a revealing is like there's something behind this curtain, and it's when the curtain comes down. When you reveal, you see, oh, that's what it is. To reveal is to inform, to make obvious, to make clear. And when we talk about knowing each other, when you talk about revealing, it's giving some information about yourself. Isn't that how we get to know each other? You know, we're surfacey at first, and I made some fantastic October friends over here, by the way. And go October. And and we got to know a little bit about each other and what plans are for this year or what not plans are for this year. One of my October friends made a fantastic plan to not make any plans, thus we wouldn't let ourselves down. But but we got to know each other's surface level. But when you really make a friend, right, it's about revealing. It's about letting something go about yourself that you don't tell everybody, like that you leave your phone on in church. The Lord is calling, whoever that is. Samuel. If it is, you might want to pick it up. You're excused. That's all right. To reveal is how we get to know each other. In fact, you really don't know somebody until you have revealed something beyond surface. Some of us have friends that we've known for a long time, but we still keep those walls up, and we say, you know what? I mean, we're friends, but how do we know each other until we actually trust enough to reveal something? And that's what it says here, that God had not yet revealed himself through his word. The word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to Samuel. Verse 8, a third time the Lord called Samuel, and Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, here I am, you called me. Then Eli realized that the Lord was calling the boy. So Eli told Samuel, go and lie down, and if he calls you, say, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now, I love what Eli does here. Eli finally figures it out. Now, you got to give the guy some credit. He was groggy. It's the middle of the night. He's getting woken up by the little church kid who keeps coming and banging on his door in the middle of the night. But finally, after three times, he goes by, oh, okay, I actually get what's going on. And he says, the Lord is calling. And so he gives instructions. If you hear it again, don't bother me. If you hear it again, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. I have that underlined in my Bible. I like that line. I think that's a great way to start every time you open up the Bible. If you do a daily devotion, and one of the things I'm going to encourage you on is to to do a daily devotion. I'll talk about that before we're done. But to get in the Word every day, as you start out, it's a great way to start. You don't need a big, long, elaborate prayer. Just speak, Lord. Your servant is listening. So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Verse 10. The Lord came and stood there, calling as at the other time, Samuel, Samuel. Then Samuel said, speak, for your servant is listening. And the Lord said to Samuel, see, I am about to do something in Israel that will make the ears of everyone who hears about it tingle. At that time, I will carry out against Eli everything I spoke against his family, from beginning to end. For I told him that I would judge his family forever because of the sin he knew about. His sons blasphemed God, and he failed to restrain them. Therefore I swore to the house of Eli, the guilt of Eli's house will never be atoned for by sacrifice or offering. Samuel lay down until morning, and then opened the doors of the house of the Lord. He was afraid to tell Eli the vision. Now, Samuel finally gets it, finally says, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. What does God say to him? I'm going to make you rich and famous, Samuel. All your ways will be wonderful. It wasn't a fortune cookie. He got a hard word. I mean, he's just met the Lord. The Lord walks in. Now, one thing I want you to notice, it says that the Lord, in verse 10, came and stood there. The Lord came and stood there. That means he came in bodily form, it would look like to me as I read it. Now, what that means exactly, I don't know. As I read it, I think my theory on this, that's the Lord. I think that's Jesus showing up. When God shows up in human form in the Old Testament, my theory, many other pastors share, I think that's Jesus showing up to talk to Samuel. And he stands there, and this first word that Samuel ever gets is, Eli, I want you to give a word to Eli. Now, if you read chapter 2, Eli's already heard this. Eli already knows. The Lord has spoken to Eli already and convicted Eli and told Eli, your sons are blaspheming God. Now, this is no small thing. By blasphemy, I don't just mean that they're using Jesus' name as a curse word, which is a serious thing, but that's not what we're talking about here. What we're talking about is abusing the women who come to worship the Lord, is abusing those who offer to God and taking from the best of what they give to God, ignoring God's rules. What does that do? Well, it causes all the people that come to God to say, if this is what God is about, if these guys represent God, what kind of God is this that we're serving? It's the greatest kind of hypocrisy to see it in the leadership of the church. It affects people. It affects people in a serious way. I tell you, there rarely do I ever face a ministry harder than trying to reach out to a kid who's been hurt because of something that a pastor did. And I've faced that on multiple occasions. I trust in God's faithfulness. I know God is true. In Romans chapter 3, even if every man is a liar, let every man be a liar, let God be true. Even if every single person ever said they follow God was a hypocrite, God is still true. Judge the two differently. But there is a reality that many of us will judge God according to those who claim to be his servants. And his servants here were blaspheming God. And so God waited, was patient with his servants. But he does bring judgment. But it's interesting to see that he gives that to Samuel, this poor teenage kid. First word he hears from the Lord is, see, I'm about to do something in Israel that will make the ears of everyone who hears about it tingle. At that time, I will carry out against Eli everything I spoke against his family from beginning to end. For I told him that I would judge his family forever because of the sin he knew about. Now, Eli hasn't done the sin, but he's guilty because he was responsible. God held the father responsible for the way he raised his sons and for failing to hold them back, knowing that they were representing God. Part of the job of the priesthood was to pass it on, to pass on what it meant to follow God. It was a father's responsibility here. Eli didn't do it. And Eli knew it, as we'll see. But think about this from Samuel's perspective. The first word he hears from the Lord. And here I want to think about faith for a second again. We talked about where faith, what faith is, the guardian of hope. And there's more to it than that. We'll get to more to it than that. And where faith comes from. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing through the Word.
We walk by faith and not by sight. It's not seeing it, it's hearing God's word and trusting in God's word. It's the word of God that begins faith, but how does it really grow? I would say sometimes it grows through the hard stuff. I brought more object lessons if you didn't notice. Skip faith for a second. Anybody make a New Year's resolution to get fit? Anybody make a New Year's resolution to get in shape a little bit? There's a couple of like tentative hands. I might say yes. I've only hit 50% so far, so I'm still considering that other resolution you mentioned not to make any resolutions. But okay, a little question: how do you get fit? Actually, we're talking about faithFIT and how you get your faith into fitness. Now, how does this thing work? Does this little barbell here build muscle? What on earth am I doing? What? I thought this is how we go about it. I mean, all the people with muscle, I see them with these things, right? And I see them with these things, or I see them with these things where they pull themselves up when they get really big. And what does this do to muscle? You said no. What do you think? What does it do to muscle? It breaks down muscle. I give up. That's ridiculous. It breaks down muscle. Did you know that? That's what weightlifting, that's what getting in shape. When you do all that exercise, it's breaking your muscle down. These things right here, they're suffering at the moment. So why do you do it? Because after the muscle is broken down, what happens? That's where this stuff comes in. You need some protein to build it back up. What happens inside your body is you break down muscle. God made your body pretty smart. As you break it down and you got all this torn up muscle, your body says, all right, if he's going to do some working out, let's give him something to work out with. And it takes some of the protein that you eat and it sends it along back to the muscle. There's more to it than that. I'm not a biologist. But it sends it back to the muscle and builds it back up again. So now you got a little more muscle to work with. In the breaking down, you get some cracks and then you fill it in. You actually get a bigger muscle than when you started with. But it doesn't happen just by the workout. Now think about this. I think faith is a lot like muscle. How does faith grow? I think that faith will take some of this, some trials. You know what it says in Romans chapter 5? Romans chapter 5 says that we rejoice in our sufferings. Isn't that ridiculous? But you know why we rejoice in our sufferings? Because we know that suffering produces perseverance. And perseverance, if you keep at it, produces character. And character, if you keep on going, produces hope. And that hope will not let us down. Our suffering produces perseverance. In other words, the suffering, it kind of wears out your faith. Did you know that? When you go through a hard time, you feel like, why is God doing this to me? Doesn't he want me to have faith? Wouldn't it work a whole lot better to make me rich and famous? Wouldn't it work a lot better to give me all of my dreams come true than I could say, look, there is God doing these great miracles? You ever notice in the Bible that miracles don't produce faith? You watch in the book of Numbers as the Israelites follow God through the desert, and everyday miracles, every single day, food just shows up on the ground. Water comes out of a rock. A huge pillar of fire comes from the sky to light up the sky to give them light at night and lands directly on the ark. And then by day, there's a big cloud they follow, and yet for all that, they can go 40 years and they still haven't produced faith. You ever notice that Jesus didn't really want to make a huge deal out of his miracles? Now, they were for a purpose. They're important. But he kept telling people to stop spreading the word. Isn't that the weirdest thing? Jesus kept telling people, don't tell anybody about it. Now, his miracles serve a purpose that for one, it was his compassion. He cared about people, wanted to help them out. Two, they proved his claims. And he used them that way. But they don't produce faith. You ever wonder at the Pharisees who saw him doing miracle after miracle? And even knowing that he's going to do miracles, Sabbath day, there's a guy who's sick, needs some healing. Jesus is here. All right, he's set up. I know he's going to heal on the Sabbath. We got him. We're going to nail him for doing work on the Sabbath, healing this guy. They had enough belief to know that Jesus could heal because they'd seen it happen again and again, but they didn't have faith. Faith doesn't come by seeing miracles. We walk by faith, not by sight. So where does faith come from? Well, it comes through the word, but also it grows as it gets broken down by the trials you go through. As you have to persevere, what does it take to build back up? Well, it breaks down by the trials. It gets built up. What do you think this is? You need some protein to build it back up. Trials by themselves don't produce faith. Did you not? If you just did this guy and you didn't eat afterwards or ever, would you build muscle? This is a very bad plan. Don't take this plan. If you go on super diet and super exercise at the same time, that's not a great combination. In fact, if you're going to exercise a lot, you got to eat more, right? You got to build it back up. And you got to eat the right foods that build you back up the right way. Now, physical exercise and physical training have a purpose. Paul says to Timothy, physical training is good, but he says, but spiritual training has a payoff for this life and for the next. And he says, train yourself to be godly. Train yourself. In other words, put yourself on a training routine. Train yourself to be godly. How does it work? Go through the trials. Now, this one comes easy. You don't always have to plan those. Those are going to come at you. They'll hit you. You don't have to go looking for them. Life will hit you. But as you go through them, you got to build yourself back up with some protein, the meat of God's word. Get the milk and the meat, the manna of God's word, to build back up that faith. Because the trials will break it down, but the faith comes by hearing, and hearing through the word about Christ. Well, Samuel gets a word from God, and this one really is a trial for him. It's not easy. Will he deliver it faithfully? Down at verse 15, Samuel lay down until morning, and then opened the doors of the house of the Lord. He was afraid to tell Eli the vision, but Eli called to him and said, Samuel, my son. Samuel answered, here I am. 17. What was it he said to you? Eli asked. Do not hide it from me. May God deal with you, be it ever so severely, if you hide from me anything he told you. So Samuel told him everything, hiding nothing from him. Then Eli said, he is the Lord. Let him do what is good in his eyes. The Lord was with Samuel as he grew up, and he let none of Samuel's words fall to the ground. Now, the story that night is over. Samuel was faithful. He heard a word from God, and he delivered the word from God. Now, this is a very big deal, because Samuel is going to be a representative for God. Now, he's not in the line of the priests, but he's going to be the last of the judges. And he'll serve much the way that a prophet does. And for all the people of Israel, Samuel will serve as the voice of God. And he'll have to speak into some very hard situations. Samuel, we're going to find out later, is the man who called up Israel's first king when they asked for a king. And he had to give some very hard words when the king went back to misrepresenting God. And then Samuel calls up David, the great king of Israel. And Samuel plays a huge role in all of the history of Israel. But you got to know where it started. If you want to make an impact on your world, if you want to speak to your world, if you want to speak to your community and bring the love of God and make a difference, you got to understand that it starts right here. He heard from the Lord, and so he spoke for the Lord, even when it was tough. Now, I'm not telling you to go around and tell everybody that Eli's news. The Lord has spoken against your family. He will bring an end to the family. If you're going to say that, you better make sure you heard something from God. Some people just like to make up stuff like that from God. But sometimes the things you have to say that God gives you aren't that easy. It's not all happy bells and whistles and God just loves you and there's no bad news at all. I have good news, no bad news whatsoever. The good news comes with bad news. There's some hard realities about life. And a lot of people get burned when Christians just give them good news. It happens a lot. People hear the happy-go-lucky Christians telling all about the great things God wants to do for you. We kind of skip through the Bible, just look at the happy promises, and don't get to promises like Jesus promised, in this world you will have trouble. Did you know that's a promise from God? That's a promise. Jesus' word himself, in this world you will have trouble. It's one of my favorite promises. You know why? Because it's right. Because it's absolutely true. You will have trouble, but that's not the end of the promise. He says, take heart. For I have overcome the world. You're going to have trouble in this world. In fact, as you read through the Bible, you'll find that There are prophets who like to say that everything's going to be good. They're almost always the false prophets, the ones who claim to represent God, always saying everything's hunky-dory and it's going to be wonderful. But Jesus said you will have trouble. And here in verse 19, we skip ahead. As Samuel grows, it says, the Lord was with Samuel as he grew up, and he let none of Samuel's words fall to the ground. I love that word picture. He let none of Samuel's words fall to the ground. Samuel grows up. He's passed this one trial from God to hear from God and deliver the word. And as he grows, he's going to be a voice for God, for all the people of Israel. And it says, God let none of Samuel's words fall to the ground. You ever say something to somebody and it just, somewhere between your mouth and their ears, just hits the ground flat? And you try, and you want to speak into somebody's life, and it's just flat. It just hits the ground. It says here that none of Samuel's words fell to the ground. Why? Because they were God's words. Because the word of the Lord is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. Because the word of God is powerful and effective. Because Samuel heard it from God first. If you want to speak into somebody else's life, yeah, they need to hear it from you. And there's a reason God speaks through people. It's different. Yes, it's wonderful God gave us his written word, but very often God chooses to speak through people. In fact, you ever notice that the Bible is not an encyclopedia of doctrine? That the Bible is not a dictionary of Bible terms, of godly things? It's not a list of directions? In fact, the New Testament, especially as you read through, it's letters from people. To people they care about. Paul is writing to churches that he loves and cares about. And Luke is writing to a close friend named Theophilus to tell him all about Jesus and give him the whole story. And John is writing to the church that he loves so much. It's from people, because God works through people. That's the way God's word works. And there's a reason that God's word comes alive. One, off the page, yes, absolutely God speaks to you, but God also will speak through you as you share his word to somebody else, because it comes through a heart that cares. Because God has moved on your heart. And the more you read the word, the more you'll find how much God loves people. And the more you'll be convicted that they need to hear it, and they need to hear it from you. And so as Samuel goes and shares the word, his words did not fall to the ground. Faith is. What is faith? I told you that faith is a guardian of hope. Faith is also the conduit of God's grace. Faith is the conduit of God's grace. You know what it says in Ephesians 2:8? Beautiful verse. One of my favorite. One of the most important in the Bible. That we are saved by grace through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. We are saved by grace through faith. In that, what that means is the way you're saved, the way your sins are forgiven, you're saved by grace. It's a gift from God. You don't deserve it. You don't earn it. You can't earn it. Don't try to earn it. God just loves you because he loves you, grace. And this is how we're saved. This is how we have hope for eternity. If you try to make your way up to God, you'll never get there. But the Lord loved us so much that he gave us a gift, the gift of salvation, the gift of hope. Jesus died to pay for our sins. He was resurrected to give us new life. He paid the full price so that we could be saved. But he gives that gift. Grace is a gift. He gives it through faith. We are saved by grace through faith. In other words, faith is a conduit. It's how grace comes to us. It's how we receive it. Faith is the messenger. It's how it brings God's grace to us. God's grace is an incredible thing. But you don't get it without faith. You get nothing without faith. In verse 20, and all Israel from Dan to Beersheba recognized that Samuel was attested as a prophet of the Lord. 21, the Lord continued to appear at Shiloh, and there he revealed himself to Samuel through his word. In chapter 4, verse 1, and Samuel's word came to all Israel. Now, this is the real fast forward of the story. Samuel grows up. He gets more and more assignments to go and speak God's word into people's lives, to bring God's grace, to bring God's conviction. But here we see how Samuel grew up. The Lord, in verse 21, continued to appear at Shiloh, and there he revealed himself to Samuel through his word. There's that word again, revealed. Now, what is revealed about? It's about relationship. It's how we get to know each other. God continues to reveal himself to Samuel. In other words, knowing God isn't just a one-time thing. It isn't just an epiphany that you light up, wow, I know God. In the same way that knowing your spouse isn't just a one-time thing. You don't just get to know them, go on one date, and kind of review the facts and say, well, now we know each other. Let's get married and go about our separate ways. Revealing is getting to know each other over time. It works that way with God. I don't care how long you've been walking with the Lord, you don't know everything. There's a lot more to know about God. And when I say know about God, I don't just mean facts. I mean get to know God. Get to know how he loves people. Get to know how he loves you. Get to know how he loves your kids. How he feels about you and your life. Get to know how he feels about science and politics. Get to know how he feels about church. There's a complicated one. Get to know God. How do you get to know God? It says, the Lord continued to appear. Now, I don't know if that means he kept showing up physically and talking to Samuel as he did that one time. I don't know. But I do know it says this, he revealed himself to Samuel through his word. It's an important verse to me. I actually have that one marked in my Bible. And it was July 22nd of 2009. I have that marked in my Bible through his word. I was out on the mission field, and I'd known God for some time, and I'd been serving the Lord and getting to know him. And at that time, I was getting to know him through some of the harder times. You know what I mean? Sometimes you get to know God through the good times. Sometimes you get to know him through the harder times. But the Bible tells us that a brother is born from adversity. That we really get to know someone close, like family, when we go through the hard stuff. Think of the closest people to you in your life. The closest people to you. I'm willing to bet you've been through some stuff together. That you went through some hard times. In fact, that's usually how you really get to know them. It's the ones who really stick by you. How do you think you get to know the Lord? Through the easy times? Yeah, I mean, it's fun to have fun with people. But you really get to know who your real friends are. You really grow in trust as you walk through the hard stuff. You want to know how to get to know God? Walk through the hard stuff together and find that he will never leave you or forsake you. 2009, I was going through some of the hard stuff. Some really difficult. I thought I was already through that part. I thought, I've been walking with the Lord for a while, and I thought I'd made it through to the other side. Well, it turns out God wanted me to know him a little bit better. And we really got hit. We moved to Mississippi in 2007. We went there with a mission team with Katrina Relief. We moved to the Gulf Coast, right at a little town called Bay St. Louis, right on the Gulf Coast. They got hit with the eye of Hurricane Katrina. We took a team of kids out there, and fast forward a little bit, turned into a couple mission trips, turned into a mission field, and turned into a church plant. We went out and planted a church. I was so excited for all the things that God was going to do. God surely wants to bless the ministry and work in the ministry, right? He gave me a word before I went out. Always for me, all my big decisions in life came with a word. God gave me a word. And this one was in 1 Thessalonians 5, 1 Thessalonians 5, 24. It says, he who called you is faithful, and he also will do it. He who called you is faithful, and he also will do it. Before I went to Mississippi, before I hit the mission field, a year and a half, kept getting that same verse from every different direction. He who called you is faithful, and he also will do it. I didn't know exactly what the it was, but I was excited about it. Because if God is doing it, then it's got to be good. He who called you is faithful, he also will do it. Well, we got to the mission field, and God was at work, and people were getting saved, but it didn't come easy. And the church wasn't exactly growing. We were hitting some hard times, but and there weren't exactly a whole lot of jobs to go around in the big recession in a place that just got hit with the largest natural disaster the country's ever seen. And most folks weren't that interested in giving away a job to a California kid who just showed up to take one of their sparse jobs. So work was few and far between, and the bills kept piling up. But in the midst of that, God kept giving me a vision of something to do. And the vision was teach the word, but not on at church. I was teaching the word at church. I love teaching the word. I love doing it. God really worked through in my life through the teaching of the word. I skipped a story. I was saved listening to the radio. I kept avoiding all those kids at on campus, the Bible thumpers, but God saved me through the radio, lo and behold. And it was Bible teaching on the radio. Now, I had tried reading the Bible on my own, but it just didn't light up. It just didn't make sense to me. It didn't click. But I got hit with the conviction a little time after the incident at St. Paul's Cathedral. A little while later, I was partying every Saturday night, going to church every Sunday morning, and didn't see anything wrong with it. I was a rave kid. We went to rave Saturday night. I'd stay up all night, and Sunday morning I would go to church, and you know, I was still awake enough and buzzed to sit in church, and then I go home, and everything was hunky dory, and didn't feel any conviction. Didn't really listen, but I also wasn't hearing the word. I wasn't listening. Well, God did something. He showed up. My wife, we were living together at the time, we weren't married. My wife said to me one day, we would go to the raves together with all our friends, and she said to me one day, "I'm not going to do drugs anymore." And I looked at her. Neither of us were addicts. We weren't big time hooked or anything. We just were party kids. And I go to school all week studying engineering, but we partied Saturday night. That's what everybody did. So we drive out to the rave, and everybody's dancing around and doing the happy drugs. That's what they do at raves. They do the happy drugs that make you feel like love, and they make you feel like joy. And they trigger enough of the chemicals in your brain to make you think it's the real thing for a little while. But right about the time that really started to wear off among all my friends, I remember my friends sitting around saying, "How come it's not fun anymore?" And their solution was to do more drugs. My wife said, "I'm going to stop." And I said, "Oh, what am I going to do?" And right about that time, a conviction came to me. I always called myself agnostic, but I never actually tried. And as a scientist, I'm studying engineering. As a scientist, can I actually say I've proven this truth about you can't prove there is a God if I haven't tried it out? And so I said a prayer to God. "God, if you're there, I'm listening." I didn't know if he was the real thing or not. I just said, "If you're there, I'm listening." After that, I thought, well, what do I do? So I thought, well, some people like this thing, so I'll try to read it. I opened up Genesis. I made my way about halfway through Exodus, and I got what I call lost in Leviticus syndrome. That I'm reading through the Bible, and right about Leviticus, like, I do not know what is happening at this point. And it kind of gets slow. It really does. But I had told God I'll give him a chance. Well, Sunday mornings, on the Saturday nights where we'd go party, Sunday mornings on the way to church, my wife and I, one of us decided we should listen to church music, because we were always listening to our rock and roll on the way to church, and let's listen to church music. So I found a station that played boring music, and I said, "That's it, that's the one." It was church music. True story. And so I found the boring music. I preset the station in my little, I think I had a Tercel at that time. I preset the station, and so that was our station. Well, during the week, I would drive for about 2 hours a day, and I started searching through my channels while I'm driving. When the commercials come on the classic rock station, I'd hit the church station, but it wasn't boring music anymore. It was somebody explaining the Bible, just going straight through the Bible and explaining the Bible. And sometimes it was Chuck Smith, and sometimes it was Raul Ryss, and sometimes it was a Calvary Chapel station, and they're just explaining the Bible. And I had never heard it like that. I was stunned. I was amazed. I heard the Passover story that I'd read through in Exodus, and there in the Passover story is the picture of Christ, who laid down his life for my sins, so that I would be passed over from death. And it was absolutely incredible to me, and the word was being revealed to me. And suddenly I started getting convicted of God's truth. This is for real. This is the real thing. Well, I got saved. I got saved with the radio. Nobody witnessed to me. Nobody came up and knocked on my door. I got saved with the radio. I was in my room in a house full of rave kids, everybody getting drunk every night. And I just got down next to my little alarm clock radio on my knees and said a prayer of salvation with the pastor who was on the radio. And after that, I'm driving every day. I'm listening to the word. I'm listening to teaching the word through the Bible. Like 2 hours a day, I'm in my car, and I'm just growing in the word, going to know God, and just falling in love with this God as he reveals himself to me. And I start reading on my own, and this habit just kind of gets into my life, and who I am, getting to know God. That was the story I skipped earlier. Fast forward a little bit, back to my story in ministry, and I'm sorry for the bouncing around. In 2009, I get this idea. I kept wanting to tell people, like, to get into the Word, but I couldn't get them to do what I was doing. When I didn't have the radio station anymore, I started putting Bible studies on my MP3 player. They were these cool new things for a while. And I put all these Bible studies on my MP3 player, and I would just listen all the time to the teaching of the Word. But I was in youth ministry at that point. I couldn't convince the kids to do it. The studies were too long. They wouldn't do it. So I got an idea. I got an idea for a daily Bible study. Keep it under 10 minutes. Give people a habit that they can keep. But I knew that habit was the key. Because if you don't do it as a habit, you don't really do it. You understand that about life? If you don't do it as a habit, you're not really doing it. I'd say 95, maybe even for most, some of us, 99% of life is habits. And if you don't do it as a habit, you're not really doing much of it. If you say that you date your spouse, but you don't have it on the calendar as a, like, every Friday night or every other Friday night or at least once a month Friday night, when's the last time you took your spouse on a date? If you say that you pray, yeah, I'm a praying person, but you don't have a time of day when it's your time to pray, when's the last time you prayed? Well, before dinner. Well, I know. Before dinner. That's great. You know why you do that? It's a habit. That's why you do it. Almost everything you do is a habit. I would challenge you to think of something that you've done. How many things did you do in the entire last year that weren't habits? Every day, every week, or every month, or every year? Almost all of life is habits. If you don't pray as a habit, you don't pray much. If you don't read the Word as a habit, you don't read the Word much. That's just a reality of life. I got myself a Bible habit, but I couldn't seem to give it away because something that we pastors like to do when we give away, when we tell people to read the Bible, is we like to say, you know what you got to do? You got to take 2 hours every morning. You got to get up at 4 a.m. and you got to make this happen. And you got to give, you got to get into it. And then you got to read like 4 chapters a day because you got to do the Bible in a year. And you got to read 4 chapters, you got to spend time, and you got to meditate on it, you got to spend time. And we like to say stuff like that, but the reality is most of us in the audience say, that's great. When I have time, I'll get to that. Or we try that for a day and we fail. The number one reason people give up habits, I was actually just reading a thing on New Year's resolutions. You know why Americans break so many resolutions? Because we overpromise. We overcommit. We just make promises too big. So I got this idea for 10 minutes a day. 1 chapter a day. We'll just read through. I was going to make it a podcast at first. And I started recording, and then I called it the Bible Sherpa when I started. And Bible Sherpa, you know what a Sherpa is? They guide you like they're mountain guides. I call it the Bible Sherpa, but no, people didn't get it. They told me they thought it was a goat. And the other half of people thought it was a jacket, and neither of them made any sense. So I was sitting in my living room one day, and I suddenly got the word through. And through, there's a long story to that. I won't tell you the whole story. The word through meant a lot to me for a number of reasons. But I thought, through the Word. Through the Word. That's what we want to do. I want people to go through the Word. 1 chapter every day, you go through the Word. But as you go through the Word, so I suddenly just liked this term. I looked it up, and there was no big ministry called through the Word, like through the Word. I looked at my concordance, and I found through the Word. I found, you know what I found? Romans 10:17. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing through the Word. I found in Ephesians 5 that Christ washes his bride. He washes us through the Word. That's how he makes us clean. It's soap for the soul, the Word is. And then I found this in 1 Samuel chapter 3, that the Lord revealed himself to Samuel through his word. And I said, that is what I want my app to do. I don't want people to just check off they read their Bible today. I want God to reveal himself through his word. So from the beginning, through the word has always had a double meaning. We go through the Bible, but more importantly than that, God comes through his word. And he's made known to you and reveals himself to you. Now, I'm just about out of time, but this one thing I want to give you. I want to give you a Bible habit. I want to get you in the Word every day. Pastor Russell was kind enough to invite me to come and speak to you for one night. And you know what I'd like to say? I'd like you guys to be able to walk away from here and say, that was life-changing. That was so incredibly inspiring. This is what pastors dream about. They walk away. We don't admit that to you, but like, wow, that was a life-changer. That was really something. But you want to know reality? If you don't change your habits, it wasn't life-changing. I don't care how inspired you were. I don't care how moved you felt by it. If you don't change your habits, your life is not changed. See, you can make all kinds of promises. You can feel all kinds of feelings about God, but if it doesn't work its way into your habits, Samuel made a habit of opening up the Bible and reading, and that was life-changing. If it's going to be life-changing, I want you to read your Bible and pray every single day. Get in the Word, let it change you, let it grow you. I did a wedding a couple weeks ago for a girl who means a lot to me. She was in my youth group for years. I've known her since she was probably ninth grade. And she came on every mission trip, always a heart for God. And she took a long time to find the right guy. She finally found the right guy. I really like him a lot. He's an accountant. They're a funny couple because she just feels. She just has a big, big heart. She just feels. And he's an accountant, so he feels, but he doesn't show it the same way. They're doing the vows right in front of me, and it was a repeat after me, like you know, to honor and to cherish through sickness and in health, for laughter and for tears and for until death do us part, all that. And as I was doing it, as I said the repeat after me's to Amber, she just said them with her joyful big heart and just flood of her heart. But as I said it to Brandon, he every time I would say the repeat after me, I would say, you know, in sickness and in health, he'd pause and he'd think. You know why? He's an accountant. You could see it in his face. He was measuring every word he was saying, like, this is a vow before God. All right, if you're going to make these kind of vows, like, make them count. And so he'd pause, he'd think, and then he'd say it and look her right in the eye and say, in sickness and in health, for richer or for poorer. And I thought, oh, so sweet. But you know what? As wonderful as that is, a great way is to start a marriage. The value of a marriage, the depth of love, is not measured by the sincerity of your vows. It will be measured in the habits that you keep with your spouse day by day, week by week, month by month, because that's your life. How do you keep those vows? You keep them in your habits. You don't keep them by once every 10 years coming up with a great idea and giving some flowers. You keep habits together that keep you close. How do you keep your vows to God? I don't care how strongly you felt those vows at your baptism. You keep them in the habits. You get to know God in the habits. Read your Bible every day. Just let God speak to you. Speak, Lord. Your servant is listening. Pray every day. Let him hear from you. Pour out your heart. Trust him. Get to know him. Connect with God. And let God plant seeds in your heart every day. Now, I always feel a little weird when I get invited somewhere, because, like, I hate feeling like a salesman. And I have an app, so, like, do the big show. Here's my... So I don't want to say to you, like, get to know God, and this is the only way to do it. That is not true whatsoever. But it is absolutely my heart. I want you to get to know God, and I hope that we provided a great way for you to get to know God more, to get in the Word every day. Not to give you unrealistic expectations. We really tried to just give you, and we make it Word-centered. It's not a teacher telling you all his great ideas and then a little bit of Bible. It's really all about the Bible. There's the way the app works... Every day, you listen to a teacher, a Bible teacher. Some of them are me, some of them are others. And the teacher gives you an audio guide, walks you through the chapter in about 8-9 minutes. And really, it's about opening up, revealing the works. That's what Bible teachers do. That's what they did for me when I couldn't understand. That's what God calls Bible teachers for. And they open it up, but then you read it for yourself so you can really hear from God directly. And you can do that on audio as well. We made it on audio so that you can do it in your busy schedule. We want to meet real people with real needs. We get a lot of people who have no time at all. They listen on the way to work. Or they'll listen with their kids while they're driving to school. That crazy little idea that I had back in 2009, today we reach 8,000 people every day. 8,000 people open up a little app, listen to a teacher, read the Word for themselves, and find that life changes as you grow in God's Word. You know why life changes? Because there's something amazing about this little thing. It's more than meets the eye. It's a seed planted. And you'd be amazed what a little seed can do. One last verse I want to read you. Oh, by the way, I should say this. If you've had troubles with the app, I am sorry. And I mean that really. If you had any troubles with the app, I can probably show you what's wrong, because I've already had people tell me. It's an app. It comes with tech difficulties. We're actually relaunching. We're doing a full redo of the app. I'm very excited about it. We fixed a whole lot of problems. It's going to be coming out in about 2 months. Please, Lord. But if you had, there are little issues that people have with the app. If you have it playing the same chapter every day, I can show you how to fix that. It's a very easy fix. Sunday morning, I'm going to show a little more. I'll actually walk through on the screen how to do it. If you have no idea what I've been talking about this whole time, but you have a smartphone, if you go to the app store, you just type through the word. Through the word, you will find it. And if not, ask somebody. Somebody else here knows. If you don't have a smartphone, or it doesn't work on your smartphone because you have a cheap smartphone, whatever the reason, we have a website. Guess what the website is? Through the word. If you Google through the word, it's the very first thing that comes up. This is the verse I want to leave you with. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23. Pues, ustedes han nacido de nuevo. No de simiente perecedera. That's a big word. No de simiente perecedera, sino de simiente imperecedera, mediante la palabra de Dios, que vive y permanece. 1 Peter 1:23. For you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and enduring word of God. For all people are like grass, and all their glory is like the flowers of the field. Grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of the Lord endures forever. And this is the word that was preached to you. Father, we thank you for that word. We thank you for the imperishable seed that you have planted in us that we might be born again. That word does not perish within us, but it grows to everlasting life. Lord, I pray that tonight the word that came would bring faith, that faith would come by this hearing, and that seed would fall on good soil in our hearts, that it might grow, that it might bear fruit 10 times, 50 times, 100-fold, that we might share that word and give away that fruit and plant more seeds in the world around us. Lord, thank you for speaking to us tonight. Thank you for your wonderful word that helps us grow, that strengthens us. Thank you for the trials that break down our faith, and thank you for bringing us back the word that builds it back up again. Strengthen us in you, Lord. We pray these things in Jesus' name. And everybody said,
Amen.
Amen. Thank you.